Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, who as an example of humility for the human race to follow, caused our Saviour to take flesh and submit to the cross, graciously grant that we may heed his lesson of patient suffering and so merit a share in his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen. A reading from the prophet Isaiah. The Lord has given me a disciple's tongue, so that I may know how to reply to the wearied. He provides me with speech. Each morning he wakes me to hear, to listen like a disciple. The Lord has opened my ear. For my part, I made no resistance, neither did I turn away. I offered my back to those who struck me, my cheeks to those who tore at my beard. I did not cover my face against insult and spittle. The Lord comes to my help, so that I am untouched by the insults. So too I set my face like flint. I know I shall not be shamed. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. His state was divine, yet Christ Jesus did not cling to his equality with God, but emptied himself to assume the condition of a slave and become as men are. And being as all men are, he was humbler yet, even to accepting death, death on a cross. But God raised him high and gave him the name which is above all other names, so that all beings in the heavens, on earth, and in the underworld should bend the knee at the name of Jesus, and that every tongue should acclaim Jesus Christ as Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Praise to you, O Christ, King of eternal glory. Praise to you, O Christ, King of eternal glory. Christ was humbly yet, even to accepting death, death on a cross. But God raised him high and gave him the name which is above all names. Praise to you, O Christ, King of eternal glory.
The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark. It was 2 days before the Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread, and the chief priests and the scribes were looking for a way to arrest Jesus by some trick and have him put to death. For they said,
"It must not be during the festivities, or there will be a disturbance among the people."
Jesus was in Bethany, in the house of Simon the leper. He was at dinner when a woman came in with an alabaster jar of very costly ointment, pure nard. She broke the jar and poured the ointment on his head. Some who were there said to one another indignantly,
"Why waste this ointment? Ointment like this could have been sold for over 300 denarii and the money given to the poor."
And they were angry with her. But Jesus said,
"Leave her alone. Why are you upsetting her? What she has done for me is one of the good works. You have the poor with you always, and you can be kind to them whenever you wish, but you will not always have me. She has done what was in her power to do. She has anointed my body beforehand for its burial. I tell you solemnly, wherever throughout all the world the good news is proclaimed, what she has done will be told also in remembrance of her."
Judas Iscariot, one of the 12, approached the chief priests with an offer to hand Jesus over to them. They were delighted to hear it and promised to give him money, and he looked for a way of betraying him when the opportunity should occur. On the first day of Unleavened Bread, when the Passover lamb was sacrificed, his disciples said to him,
"Where do you want us to go and make the preparations for you to eat the Passover?"
So he sent two of his disciples, saying to them,
"Go into the city, and you will meet a man carrying a pitcher of water. Follow him, and say to the owner of the house which he enters, 'The master says, where is my dining room in which I can eat the Passover with my disciples? He will show you a large upper room furnished with all couches, all prepared. Make the preparations for us there.'"
The disciples set out and went to the city and found everything as he had told them and prepared the Passover. When evening came, he arrived with the 12. And while they were at table eating, Jesus said,
"I tell you solemnly, one of you is about to betray me. One of you eating with me."
They were distressed and asked him one after another,
"Not I, surely."
He said to them,
"It is one of the 12, one who's dipping into the same dish with me. Yes, the Son of Man is going to his fate, as the scriptures say he will. But alas for that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. Better for that man if he had never been born."
And as they were eating, he took some bread, and when he had said the blessing, he broke it and gave it to them, saying,
"Take it, this is my body."
Then he took the cup, and when he had returned thanks, he gave it to them, and all drank from it. And he said to them,
"This is my blood, the blood of the covenant, which is to be poured out for many. I tell you solemnly, I shall not drink any more wine until the day I drink the new wine in the kingdom of God."
After psalms had been sung, they left for the Mount of Olives. And Jesus said to them,
"You will all lose faith, for the scripture says, I shall strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered. However, after my resurrection, I shall go before you to Galilee."
Peter said,
"Even if all lose faith, I will not."
And Jesus said to him,
"I tell you solemnly, this day, this very night, before the cock crows twice, you will have disowned me three times."
But he repeated still more earnestly,
"If I have to die with you, I will never disown you."
And they all said the same. They came to a small estate called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to his disciples,
"Stay here while I pray."
Then he took Peter and James and John with him, and a sudden fear came over him and great distress. And he said to them,
"My soul is sorrowful to the point of death. Wait here and keep awake."
And going on a little further, he threw himself on the ground and prayed that, if it were possible, this hour might pass him by. He said,
"Abba, Father, everything is possible for you. Take this cup away from me. But let it be as you, not I, would have it."
He came back and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter,
"Simon, are you asleep? Had you not the strength to keep awake 1 hour? You should be awake and praying not to be put to the test. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak."
Again, he went away and prayed, saying the same words. And once more he came back and found them sleeping. Their eyes were so heavy, and they could find no answer for him. He came back a third time and said to them,
"You can sleep on now and take your rest. It is all over. The hour has come. Now the Son of Man is to be betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up, let us go. My betrayer is close at hand already."
Even while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, came up with a number of men armed with swords and clubs, sent by the chief priests and the scribes and the elders. Now the traitor had arranged a signal with them. He had said,
"The one I kiss, he is the man. Take him in charge and see he is well guarded when you lead him away."
So when the traitor came, he went straight up to Jesus and said,
"Rabbi,"
and kissed him. The others seized him and took him in charge. Then one of the bystanders drew his sword and struck out at the high priest's servant and cut off his ear. Then Jesus spoke,
"Am I a brigand that you had to set out to capture me with swords and clubs? I was among you teaching in the temple day after day, and you never laid hands on me. But this is to fulfill the scriptures."
And they all deserted him and ran away. A young man who followed him had nothing on but a linen cloth. They caught hold of him, but he left the cloth in their hands and ran away naked. They led Jesus off to the high priest, and all the chief priests and the elders and the scribes assembled there. Peter had followed him at a distance, right into the high priest's palace, and was sitting with the attendants, warming himself at the fire. The chief priests and the whole Sanhedrin were looking for evidence against Jesus on which they might pass the death sentence, but they could not find any. Several indeed brought false evidence against him, but their evidence was conflicting. Some stood up and submitted this false evidence against him.
"We heard him say, 'I am going to destroy this temple made by human hands, and in 3 days build another, not made by human hands.'"
But even on this point, their evidence was conflicting. The high priest then stood up before the whole assembly and put this question to Jesus.
Have you no answer to that? What is this evidence these men are bringing against you?
But he was silent and made no answer at all. The high priest put a second question to him.
Are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed One?
Jesus said,
I am. And you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming with the clouds of heaven.
The high priest tore his robes and said,
What need of witnesses have we now? You heard the blasphemy. What is your finding?
And they all gave their verdict. He deserved to die. Some of them started spitting at him and blindfolding him, began hitting him with their fists and shouting,
Slay the prophets.
The attendants rained blows on him. While Peter was down below in the courtyard, one of the high priest's servant girls came up. She saw Peter warming himself there, stared at him, and said,
You too were there with Jesus, the man from Nazareth.
But he denied it, saying,
I do not know. I do not understand what you're talking about.
And he went out into the forecourt. The servant girl saw him and again started telling the bystanders,
This fellow is one of them.
But again, he denied it. A little later, the bystanders themselves said to Peter,
You are one of them for sure. Why, you are a Galilean.
But he started calling down curses on himself and swearing,
I do not know the man you speak of.
At that moment, the cock crew for the second time. And Peter recalled how Jesus had said to him, Before the cock crows twice, you will have disowned me three times. And he burst into tears. First thing in the morning, the chief priests, together with the elders and scribes, in short, the whole Sanhedrin, had their plan ready. They had Jesus bound and took him away and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate questioned him.
Are you the king of the Jews?
He answered.
It is you who say it.
And the chief priests brought many accusations against him. Pilate questioned him again.
Have you no reply at all? See how many accusations they're bringing against you.
But to Pilate's amazement, Jesus made no further reply. At festival time, Pilate used to release a prisoner for them, anyone they asked for. Now, a man called Barabbas was then in prison with the rioters who had committed murder during the uprising. When the crowd went up and began to ask Pilate the customary favor, Pilate answered them,
Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?
For he realized it was out of jealousy that the chief priests had handed Jesus over. The chief priests, however, had incited the crowd to demand that he should release Barabbas for them instead. Then Pilate spoke again.
But in that case, what am I to do with the man you call king of the Jews?
They shouted back,
Crucify.
Pilate asked them,
Why? What harm has he done?
But they shouted all the louder,
Crucify.
So Pilate, anxious to placate the crowd, released Barabbas for them, and having ordered Jesus to be scourged, handed him over to be crucified. The soldiers led him away to the inner part of the palace, that is the praetorium, and called the whole cohort together. They dressed him up in purple, twisted some thorns into a crown, and put it on him. And they began saluting him.
Hail, King of the Jews.
They struck his head with a reed and spat on him, and they went down on their knees to do him homage. When they had finished making fun of him, they took off the purple and dressed him in his own clothes. They enlisted a passerby, Simon of Cyrene, father of Alexander and Rufus, who was coming in from the country to carry his cross. They brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. They offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he refused it. Then they crucified him and shared out his clothing, casting lots to decide which each should get. It was the third hour when they crucified him. The inscription giving the charge against him read, the King of the Jews. And they crucified two robbers with him, one on his right and one on his left. The passers-by jeered at him. They shook their heads and said,
"So you will destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days.
Save yourself and come from the cross."
The chief priests and the scribes mocked him among themselves in the same way. They said,
"He said others, he cannot save himself. Let the Christ, the King of Israel, come down from the cross now, for us to see it and believe."
Even those who were crucified with him taunted him. When the sixth hour came, there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice,
"Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani,"
which means, my God, why have you deserted me?" When some of those who stood by heard this, they said,
"Listen, he is calling on Elijah."
Someone ran and soaked a sponge in vinegar, and putting it on a reed, gave it to him to drink, saying,
"Wait and see if Elijah will come to take him down."
But Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last. And the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The centurion, who was standing in front of him, had seen how he had died, and he said,
"In truth, this man was a son of God."
And there were some women watching from a distance. Among them were Mary of Magdala, Mary who was the mother of James the younger, and Joseph and Salome. These used to follow him and look after him when he was in Galilee. And there were many other women there who had come up to Jerusalem with him. It was now evening, and since it was preparation day, that is, the vigil of the Sabbath, there came Joseph of Arimathea, a prominent member of the council, who himself lived in the hope of seeing the kingdom of God. And he boldly went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Pilate, astonished that he should have died so soon, summoned the centurion and inquired if he was already dead. Having assured this by the centurion, he granted the corpse to Joseph, who bought a shroud, took Jesus down from the cross, wrapped him in the shroud, and laid him in a tomb which had been hewn out of the rock. He then rolled a stone against the entrance to the tomb. Mary of Magdala and Mary the mother of Joseph were watching and took note of where he was laid.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Well, it seems like an ordinary day today, an ordinary week, just seeking into April. The sun is shining, which is a change, isn't it, recently, when we've had rain after rain after rain after rain. Just all seems very ordinary. But actually, it isn't ordinary, because today we enter the most important week of the year, the holiest week of the year. And if we travel through it, taking each day as it happens, and of course we can do that here in this church every day, we're in for an emotional roller coaster. But as we go through it, we find that each day there are some important connections to be made with how life really is for us, each of us in our human lives. This isn't just disconnected ritual. It speaks to each of us in the very depths of our being. If, of course, we make the commitment to be here and involve ourselves in it. And so today we sing hosannas in praise of a king riding on a donkey. And kings on donkeys may sound an odd illusion. After all, donkeys are not animals. We associate with pomp and great triumph. But to first century Jews, the image would have been very clear. There's a psalm that refers to the king, the promised Messiah, riding on a donkey, a colt that's never been ridden. And this was the sign that he, Jesus, was the one they were looking for, and more than looking for, longing for in the depths of their hearts. And the message, of course, is transparent. You have been looking for the Messiah, the promised one. Well, here he is, riding on the donkey. You're looking for the Messiah. Here he is. Your hearts yearn for your salvation. He is your Savior. And we too have the prospect of our hopes and our dreams and our deepest desires, deepest needs being fulfilled. We take the one who looks like they fit how we want things to be and are elated. But there's a surprise in store. Jesus doesn't fulfill our dreams as we expect. He transforms them. So while we sing hosannas at the prospect of promises being fulfilled, in the distance stands the cross. And our neat plans, our jubilation, will be disturbed. And we remember this visually, don't we, and spiritually this morning, in palm leaves, waved in jubilation, Hosanna to the Son of David, the Messiah is here. But those palm leaves today are bent into the shape of the cross. God refuses to fit our agenda, our expectation of him. He fulfills in his own way. And that's not how we expect, though it does exceed all that we could and do desire. The Jews, of course, expected a great military leader. What did they get? A crucified king. They expected someone who would drive out the Romans. And what happened was very different. His victory was much more than those things. His victory was over death and his kingdom everlasting, not just taking the place of the Roman Empire and passing away in its own time, but an everlasting king without geographical or temporal limitations. But that, of course, is all in the future as we journey through this dramatic and most amazing of weeks. And we continue through the week. We see Jesus overturning the money changers' tables, a bit of revolutionary action. And that looks promising. The struggle started. Well, it has, but not in the way they were expecting. There's a celebration meal, a banquet fit for a king. Then in the middle of it, he does odd things. He takes a towel and starts washing his disciples' feet. The top man does the lowliest job. And he shows us that this way of service and giving is how we imitate him. Not to be concerned for our status, but to be imitators of the servant king. He also takes bread and wine and gives them a new significance. Makes them himself, makes them the Eucharist, the Blessed Sacrament, the Holy Communion, which we celebrate at this and every Mass. And then the agony in the garden. Jesus wrestling with something which he doesn't want to face. As we sometimes wrestle with things we don't want to face. And his anguish at coming to terms at his inevitable vocation. And it doesn't take much imagination for us to find links in our own lives with those things. And then, of course, it all goes downhill rapidly, or at least appears to, as we've just been reminded. There's a betrayal, a mob lynching as Jesus is arrested. Peter denies Jesus to save his own skin. Everybody who should have stayed with him and stood by him and supported him scatters and leaves him to his fate. He's left alone and isolated. And only the women and John are prepared to be identified with him, but only when it's far too late and he's already hanging nailed to the tree. And all of that we commemorate on Maundy Thursday. And then Good Friday, the day he died. So many have found links with this passion. The mothers who, like Our Lady, have known the agony of a child's death, share her pain. The moments that we may have felt that we have been crucified, that we've been broken by the actions of others, by the crosses that they place on our shoulders that we can't bear. The crosses you bring to this Mass this morning, the crosses of pain, of illness, of worry, of bereavement, all those crosses we all bear. And of course, sometimes carrying those crosses, we fall under their weight. And we need a stranger like Simon of Cyrene to come to our aid. And the moments of death and of somebody special dying, these are our Good Friday moments. And like the women who wept for Jesus, in truth, we sometimes weep for ourselves. Death is part of life and we wonder at its mystery. And then there's the astounding cruelty of those who devised crucifixion and those who carried it out. Sometimes we can act, human beings can act in ways that are so cruel as to defy our comprehension. And this is going on even as we celebrate this Mass this morning in parts of the world. People are being tortured and humiliated and killed. And the hatred and the sheer indifference to the sufferings of others can come in different guises. Of course it can. But it's always a denial of the image of God in which we and all people are created. And we can analyze the psychology of it, but with each blow of the hammer, we're forced to confront the darkness within. Within others, but also within ourselves. There are, of course, the moments when we've seen something we thought was going to last forever come to a sudden end. The shattered dreams and crushing moments of utter desolation. Only on Friday did I take a call and had to go to the DGH to give somebody the last rites. And Jesus dies. And as Jesus dies, we face the silence that is death. We also find that for some, life goes on as normal. Some are untouched. Some weep. Some mock. Some are ashamed. Some have jobs to do. Some just stand and embrace each other for support. All those things happened at the first Good Friday. What will we be doing on this Good Friday? Living our lives as normal? Or will we be here contemplating the mystery of God who loves us so much he was prepared to die in shame on the tree? Good Friday. Jesus is then buried, and there's a gap in the story. Nothing much happens. We jump from his burial to Easter Day, but the gap, what we call Holy Saturday, is an important day to hold. And sometimes we tend to lose it because we spend it decorating the church for the Easter celebrations, but there's something about holding that day of neither dying nor rising, but being stone cold. And if some experiences in our lives are like being crucified, and some are like the joy of Easter, where new life comes, where previously there was death, then there are others, sometimes long other experiences, that are neither being crucified nor rising. They are the being flat and waiting for the Easter that will come. And Jesus is with us in these moments, as he is with the crucifying and also the jubilation, the elation of looking to promises being fulfilled. And of course, the promises don't really feel fulfilled until we get to the Easter experience, whatever form that takes for us. But as we go through the others this Holy Week, they carry the promise of fulfillment, and therefore it's hope too, because he is with us. And we find connections between his story and our story. And this week is the most holy of all weeks. It also touches some of the most profound experiences we can have as human beings. And through them, we are assured of God's presence, even when we might be tempted to think he is absent. And how many of us have ever felt that in our lives? I admit to it myself. And that night of the Easter Vigil, next Saturday, when we begin the 3 days, which are both at the center of our Christian year and also at the center of the mystery of our very existence, we recall the wondrous events of the passion, death, and resurrection of our Lord and Savior, the most important part of Holy Week. Maundy Thursday, Good Friday, Easter Day, and the Paschal Vigil the night before. That three-day feast is the central feast of the year for us. It is, in fact, what distinctively defines us. And everything we do and are in the other 51 weeks of the year takes its meaning from the mysteries into which we enter in those three special days. And these are days to be experienced, to be enjoyed, to be prayed through, to be experienced, not to be missed. Let's commit ourselves today to enter into the mystery this week. Why? Because his story is our story. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Christ suffered and died so that we might become sons and daughters of God. As such, we can now pray to the Father in confidence.
For forgiveness for the many times we have denied Jesus, let us pray to the Lord. For grace to seek out those habits of sin, which mean spiritual death, and by prayer and self-discipline to overcome them, let us pray to the Lord. For those who make laws, interpret them, and administer them, that our common life may be ordered in justice and mercy, let us pray to the Lord. For those living in places of violence and conflict, and for those who work for justice and peace, let us pray to the Lord. For those in the darkness of isolation, that they may find support and encouragement, let us pray to the Lord. For those who weighed down with hardship, failure, sickness, or sorrow, feel that God is far from them, let us pray to the Lord. That we, with those who have died in faith, may find mercy in the day of Christ, let us pray to the Lord. Let us offer to God the prayers of our own hearts. Mary stood at the cross of Jesus with John, his beloved disciple. So we ask for their prayers as we say together, Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death.
Father, keep before our eyes the suffering and death of your Son. May we find in him strength for our journey and victory over every evil. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Lord, wash away my sins.
Pray, dear friends, that this, my sacrifice and yours, may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice of your hands, for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the Lord's holy Church.
Through the passion of your only begotten Son, O Lord, may our reconciliation with you be near at hand, so that, though we do not merit it by our own deeds, yet by this sacrifice made once for all, we may feel already the effects of your mercy, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your heart.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For though innocent, he suffered willingly for sinners, and accepted unjust condemnation to save the guilty. His death has washed away our sins, and his resurrection has purchased our justification. And so with all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name
indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy, and you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial